Based on the current mainstream GPU market, I have a strong feeling that AMD probably hopes that no one will remember the 6-year-old Polaris architecture chipset. Why this is so, and what graphics card I am referring to specifically, is the main topic of this video that it took a lot of work and a great deal of time to create and present to you as best as I could. So I really hope you enjoy every minute of it. The story begins in Taipei. It is June 1st, 2016, a few months after the kickoff of NVIDIA's Pascal architecture, and it is AMD's time to launch their high-end performance graphics card based on Polaris 10 chipset, the RX 480. Available in versions of 4 and 8GB 256-bit 8GBps GDDR5 video memory, a huge step forward moving from the 2011 28nm lithography into 2016 14nm FinFET technology. AMD focused their advertising strategy on the performance-to-cost ratio, knowing already that they couldn't match the raw power of NVIDIA's more expensive high-end graphics cards. At real MSRP price of $210 and $250 for the 4 and the 8GB variation respectively, AMD could indeed offer VR-ready to the masses an affordable 1080p gaming. The question was, at how many frames per second and overall, what was the offering gameplay experience? To answer that, I played some games using the Sapphire's RX 480 8GB Reference Edition with my reasonable budget gaming PC, whose hardware and software specification you can find in the description below. I started off with a gaming title from the past, promoted back then by AMD itself as a game perfectly optimized for RX 480. Unfortunately, the demo version of Doom crashed every time I enable Vulkan API. So I switched to OpenGL API 1080 resolution and ultra settings. And the card rendered averaged 68 and on 1% low 55 FPS, granting without doubt an immersive gaming experience without the need to spend almost double the money to buy NVIDIA's GTX 1070. Since AMD was promoting the cards ready for 2K gaming, here it is Doom at 1440 running at 62 average with the 1% low sinking to 52. While AMD team kept its promise the video settings had to drop to medium, otherwise the overall experience would be very stuttery. Another old but visually impressive game with magnificent landscapes, seasonal weather conditions, and day-to-night cycle is Forza Horizon 4. DirectX 12 and Ultra setting at 1080, the Sapphire RX 480 reached average 79 and 1% low 69 FPS. Good results I saw also at 1440 resolution, but this time at high settings, getting on average 77 frames and 68 at 1% low. Shadow of Tomb Raider is considered, even for today's standard, a quite demanding game. The integrated benchmark with DirectX 12 enabled and high settings at 1080p run on average 67 frames per second and 58 on 1% low. Unfortunately, on the same quality but at 1440's resolution, the previous smooth frame time became quite jumpy, so I had to drop the quality to low and got on average 78 frames per second with a 1% low rising to 69. The Division 2 is another game that includes a quite demanding integrated benchmark. Choosing DirectX 12 at 1080 high settings, the RX 480 performed decently, hitting 76 and 58 frames on average and 1% low. Once more, at 1440, I had to drop the settings to low to get satisfying frames. Because of this, I was doubtful if the car could run gaming titles made after 2020 at decent frames while using resolutions higher than 1080. So, it was time to put RX 480 under some real pressure, testing it with Hitman's 3 Dartmoor Scene, a very stressful build in benchmark incorporating a sheer number of explosions and high amount of textures and shadows, pushing to the limit the computing and rendering performance of both CPU and GPU. 1080 high settings, I saw for the first time the card struggling to meet the minimum 60fps. The more beautiful but less demanding Dubai scene at the same settings gave better results with 76 and 50 average and 1% low FPS respectively. Same scene, but this time at 1440, and I had to drop the settings to low to keep the average FPS above 60. Playing a bit the training prologue, things become a bit better. At 1080 high, the gameplay was smooth like butter, reaching the 85 average FPS and missing by one the minimum 60 or 1% low. Repeating the prologue at 1440, I had to drop the settings to low to keep the performance in par with the 1080 results. The results of Hitman 3 reveal that modern demanding AAA titles to run at resolutions above 1080, even at low settings, need to pair with something faster than RX 480, if you want, of course, to stay above the requested 60fps at all times. In fact, Halo Infinite was the first game in this benchmark that I won't even bother to show you the 1440 footage, since the RX 480 at best manages to run the game like a slideshow. At 1080 high, on the free multiplayer mode, I got a very satisfying old-gen game console experience. Even when I dropped the settings at medium, I couldn't surpass on average the 60fps. The truth is, the experience wasn't so bad. The gameplay was playable. But bear in mind that the multiplayer mode with the restricted in size maps is less demanding than the open world campaign mode. Thus, if you want to play the latter, you should look for something better than the RX 480. Godfall is my new addition to my underdevelopment benchmarking toolbox, mostly because it implements FSR features, it contains a built-in benchmark, and it is demanding enough to push any GPU to the limit. So I began with the integrated benchmark. The 1080 high settings gave 73 average FPS, which was great, but that metric was only half the story, even though the 41 frames per second on 1% low wasn't so terrible. The constant and sudden frame drops each time the character did a combination of strikes made occasionally the frame time very jumpy. Considering the fact that the CPU was barely reaching 20% utilization and the video memory wasn't exceed the 8GB, I could only blame at that point the benchmark itself or the inability of the GPU to keep up with the demanding scenes. At low settings, beyond the obvious visual quality drop, the FPS increased significantly, but the 85% gap between the overall frames and the 1% low made the gameplay at times very stuttery. So I played a bit the first part of the game on high settings, witnessing again a big difference between the 1% low and the overall FPS, causing a very bumpy gameplay experience. Enabling FSR on ultra quality shortened the frame difference and made the frame timeline less erratic, but it didn't solve the problem completely. Ultra quality FSR on low 1080 and the problem remained, however, it occurred less often. If you don't care about the muddy video fidelity, that is the lowest setting scenario playing this game with an RX 480. For the end, I left a less resource-demanding but very well-known, fast-paced, eSport game. eSport? Fortnite, updated with the latest and greatest Unreal 5 engine, feels more unoptimized overall compared to the past. If you want to know more about that and how you can optimize your graphics card to produce the highest frames per second while playing Fortnite, check the appeared card at the top right corner or open the links in the description below. Regardless, the RX 480 did great both in performance and DirectX 12. The latter was more optimal with higher 1% low and smoother frame time graph. The footage you are watching right now is from Rumble mode, the 177 and 92 average and 1% low FPS respectively are a strong indication that AMD's RX 480 will run effortless Fortnite and overall the majority of free-to-play, fast-paced esports games for many, many years to come. Revisiting again the 6-year-old hardware, I can definitely state that RX 480 was back then and continues to be today a decent graphics card. Despite the initial troublesome launch with the unoptimized drivers and the tendency the card had to overload motherboard's PCI Express bus, furthermore, the fact that the reference edition and some other AIO models had an insufficient cooling system, forcing users to undervolt the chipset in order to have less noisy and cooler graphics card. And don't get me started on how the first wave of crypto coin booming and the GPU price gouging back in 2017 made the RX 480 an impossible to buy product. Now, if you take all of that out of the equation, AMD succeeded in producing 6 years ago a mid-tier GPU with a bunch of amazing features at such a low price that we haven't seen anything like it since then. What we have seen since then is totally the opposite situation. In the year of 2022, AMD offers high-performance graphics cards starting at the premium price of $1,000. Even at the lower spectrum of AMD's GPU inventory, we see graphics cards at the same price that RX 480 was introduced in 2016, but with lower technical specifications compared to RX 480. The 4 PCI Express lanes instead 16, with only 2 video outputs instead of 4, with only 4GB 64-bit instead of 8GB 256-bit video memory, with no video encoding capabilities to record videos and no streaming or video editing capacity. Furthermore, if you belong to the majority of people who owns a motherboard that supports PCI Express 3 technology, then the RX 480 will perform in some games slightly better than AMD's modern low-tier GPUs. This is the reason why AMD would like you to forget what the same company achieved 6 years ago. Back then, AMD's main strategy was how much value we can offer without exceeding a specific budget, thus giving the opportunity even the gamers on a budget to gain access to premium hardware. Today, AMD pretty much doesn't care about the low-tier GPU market nor the needs of the low-budget consumers. Their main focus is where the big money is, and therefore, they forgot how it was to create a great chipset at amazing price without the need to scrap at ridiculous levels every useful feature to decrease the production costs. Until AMD gets better, would I recommend to buy a used RX 480 in 2022? Probably not. Unless you belong to the adventures type and you don't mind to buy a used product with unknown usage history. On the other hand, if you already own such a card, you can hold on to it, enjoying most of the upcoming PC games, mainly at 1080 low to medium settings, and once in a while, playing some low demanding games at 1440 low settings. Now the real question is how long you can use the RX 480 for gaming before it becomes completely obsolete. To find the answer to that, you should take a closer look at the current gaming industry. The vast majority of AAA games are released first on game consoles and then ports to PC. For this reason, I like to think that whenever game developers produce a game, they have in the back of their heads the PlayStation 5 and Xbox Series as absolute maximum and minimum hardware standards. Even though you cannot directly compare the GPU power of a game console with that of a graphics card, there are some valid correlations between the weaker in specs 1080p able Xbox Series S and Nvidia's graphics card GTX 1660, if the latter, of course, had also ray tracing capabilities. In terms of performance, AMD's RX 480 chipset is 25% slower than GTX 1660, placing it at the lowest spectrum of the 1080p ready GPU list. Since the upcoming wave of the next-gen consoles will not happen before 2026, I can mousy predict that Xbox Series S will remain the standard minimum hardware requirement for all the upcoming games. Therefore, I anticipate that Sapphire RX 480 8GB edition, combined with AMD's FSR technology, will remain relevant for the next 4 to 5 years. In case that you want a more future-proof option, you should check the video that are appearing right now in the corresponding end screen window. Regardless that, take care, farewell, goodbye, see you in a while.